صدق الله العظيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمدٍ وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Today is November 3rd, 2019, which is the 6th of Rabi' al-Awwal, 1441. So about 450 years ago, on the same month, which is Rabi' al-Awwal, something important happened. A person was born who changed the face of the history, and without him, none of us would be here. None of us probably would have known each other either without him. On this month, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born, and as we discussed last week, that his birth was expected and prophesied by many, you know, Christian and Jewish scholars at that time. In fact, the name of Muhammad himself was also prophesied and was known before even his birth. It was reported that a few years before the Prophet's birth, one Arab tribe from Mecca was traveling north, and they met a Christian monk, and they asked them, where are they from? And they replied, they are from Mecca. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. They are from Mecca. And he told them that Allah will send a prophet from their area who will guide them, you know, to a new way of life. So they asked him, does this prophecy say whose name is? And they said that yes, his name is Muhammad. So the Arabs, when they heard this, some of these families have committed that maybe that person is going to be their son, and therefore whatever the newborn came to them, several of them, actually they called their son Muhammad. And before the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there actually was five people or five children that were called Muhammad. And here is the name: Muhammad ibn Sufyan ibn Mujahish, Muhammad ibn Ahiha ibn al-Hallaj al-Awsi, Muhammad ibn Jassan al-Ja'fi, Muhammad ibn Bara'at al-Bakri, and Muhammad ibn Khuza'a al-Salami. And then after the Prophet ﷺ born, there was another person called Muhammad, and he Muhammad ibn Musaylam al-Ansari. So there were several people that been actually called Muhammad at that time. And it may have been from Allah subhanahu plan and will that several people will call the Muhammad, so these prophecies about him, people will not recognize who is the one from that his name, who is the one, the prophet that will be coming, and this is for his protection. And Allahu A'lam. Now, you all know the details of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so I'm not going to discuss it today. However, my plan, inshallah, to discuss actually the last few days of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they also happen in this month, in Rabi' al-Awwal. And the reason why I want to focus on this, because it is expected that if anyone is going to be on the dead, in the deathbed, he will give his family an advice. And this advice will be the most important and concise advice he will give them. And this is why I want to focus in the end, because I want to know what advice the Prophet ﷺ gave to the Muslims when he was on the deathbed. And we take this advice, because that should have been the most important advice that the Prophet ﷺ gave to us. And he did. So. But before I discuss this, I want to actually discuss another subject, because during that time, always have been, you know, during that time when the time of Rabi' al-Awwal and the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is always controversy created among Muslims, you know. And they will say, now, should we celebrate the birth of the day of the Prophet or shouldn't celebrate? And people say, oh, celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a bid'ah. So I want to discuss a little bit what is bid'ah, because this is something that people use so loosely and attack anything as bid'ah. If they don't are familiar with it, they consider it as a bid'ah. There is actually two probably main or key hadith to the Prophet sallallahu, which define what is bid'ah, and people use to attack every action as a bid'ah. And this is a hadith that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to always make this statement, you know, during the Friday khutbah. And I think you see most people make that Friday khutbah, the beginning of it, you always see the khatib making this statement in Asdaq al-Hadith Kitabullah, wa ahsan al-hadi hadi Muhammad, wa shar al-umuri muhdathatuha, wa kullu muhdathatin bid'ah, wa kullu bid'atin dalala. And listen to the word bid'ah here, wa kullu bid'atin dalala, wa kullu dalalatin finnar. So you hear this statement is made, and this is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and which mean, and you all understand what it means. It means that the most truthful speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad, and the worst of matter is novelty, and every novelty is a bid'ah. Bid'ah means innovation, and every innovation or every bid'ah is misguided and misguidance, and every misguidance leads to the hellfire. So that is a key, you know, hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is another hadith to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is also is important. And this is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu." And I'm focusing in the word minhu because it's actually very important, you know, basically proposition here. "Ma ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fa huwa radd." And whoever introduced in our matter is the religion, which is the Islam, that which is not from it, is not from it, which mean who is not from it, it is rejected. So the word bid'ah, actually linguistically, as I said, it means it's innovation, and it means bringing something original that did not exist before. Bid'ah means bring something new that hasn't existed before. And this is why Allah subhanahu when he say badi'u as-samawati wal-ard, because Allah is the originator, is the creator, is the innovator of the heavens and earth. Heavens and earth didn't exist before, and Allah subhanahu made them exist. So the word bid'ah to talk about something hasn't existed before. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is verse 117, it says, "Badi'u as-samawati wal-ard, wa idha qada amran fa innama yaqulu lahu kun fayakun." That Allah is badi', is we said the innovator, the originator, the creator of the heavens and the earth. When he decrees a matter, he said it be and it becomes. So that's what the concept of bid'ah, coming to this origin, something that focus on it, that something hasn't happened before. But also, there is another, while condemning, Prophet ﷺ condemned the bid'ah, he actually encouraged something else, which he call it sunnah. And sunnah is a norm or a custom, that you can come with something new also. And he said in this hadith, whoever establishes in Islam a good sunnah, he will have its reward and the rewards of everybody who follow it without reducing the reward of the followers. And whoever establishes in Islam a bad sunnah, so there is a good sunnah and a bad sunnah, sunnatun hasana and sunnatun, you know, sayyah. So that if he one establish a bad sunnah, then he will have its penalty and the penalty of everyone who followed this sunnah without reducing their own penalty. So it's a very, you know, critical condition that if you are going to do something, then it better be good, because if everybody followed you, you will, and it's not, if everybody followed you, it is, you will take a reward also. But if it is bad and everybody follows you or people follows you, then you are feeling the pain and getting the penalty of that, of this action too, without obviously reducing, you know, them, because everybody has to make his own decision. You cannot say I follow somebody and then say, oh, he will be an excuse for me. No, there is no excuses in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're standing alone, you're born alone, you stand alone in front of him, and you cannot say, he's told me so. You are responsible for whatever you do, no matter who is the one that misled you to this. So here is the issue. People, there are some scholars who consider, you know, that anything introduced that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do is a prohibited bid'ah, is a bad thing, you know. And they even consider the term bid'atun hasana, you know, a good innovation, is actually an unacceptable and prohibited term. Although we know that Sayyidina Umar used that term when he came to institute, you know, the group prayer with one imam for the Taraweeh. Because Sayyidina Umar, and people accused him that this is a bid'ah because the Prophet ﷺ never did it. And he said, this is a bid'ah hasana. So they don't like that term either, the usage of this term. However, there is other scholars, like, you know, major scholars, actually, like Al-Izz ibn Abd Salam and Al-Qarafi, radiallahu anhu, who consider the term good bid'ah or bid'atun hasana is an acceptable Islamic term. So they don't object to that term. And they differentiate good bid'ah from a bad bid'ah. So they said, yeah, this action could be a good bid'ah, this action could be a bad bid'ah. And they use actually a good bid'ah and a good sunnah as synonyms in this regard. But whatever everybody considered, that if you bring something that is not ever, it's something new that hasn't been in part of the religion, it's going to be a bad bid'ah. Or you can institute something as obligatory, which is not obligatory, is also a bad bid'ah. For example, if you come and wants to institute that we should do the night prayer, well, the night prayer is not obligatory. But if you institute it to everybody, even your own family, that's obligatory, then in that case, you're making a bad bid'ah because you're making a change in the religion. You consider it as a sunnah, as acceptable sunnah, you encourage people to do it. But to declare it as obligatory, that's no. Or you come with something that has nothing to do with Islam and introduce it as part of Islam. And they because they do this, because they said Islam is complete. When Allah subhanahu finished the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Allah subhanahu say it's already complete. And in Surah Al-Ma'idah, al-yawm akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam dinan. That means I have completed your religion, so you cannot add or subtract from it now. Allah subhanahu says, and fulfilled my favor upon you and have chosen for you Islam as your religion, you know. And also Allah subhanahu condemned those people who take other people to make sharia, new sharia for them. أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ شَرَّعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ وَلَوْلَا كَلِمَةُ الْفَصْلِ لَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ وَإِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Do they take partners who legislate for them some religious matter without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and for those people, they are the wrongdoers and they have a grave penalty. So whatever, you know, one uses the term good, you know, bid'ah hasana, good bid'ah, or the term sunnah hasana, the important issue that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have established the criterion of the definition, and this is a subtle issue, and this is in this hadith when he said, man ahdasa fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa radd. So and the key term in this hadith is actually the proposition min hu. It's min hu, which is translated as from it. Which could have different if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam changed it and they said ma laysa fihi. Fihi means in it, not from it, but in it. So, and this is a subtle, you know, there is a subtle difference between the term is from it, and the term in it. So here is the challenge that people, you know, scholar who come and say, okay, this is not a bid'ah because they said the hadith doesn't say in it, it say from it. And for example, sitting together, and deciding to as encourage each other, each one of us will take one juz of the Quran and read it. And then to do and the dua, finishing the Quran, you know, at the end. If this is something that the Prophet ﷺ never did. So is it bid'ah? Here is two things. Here is the basically a content of the action and the form of the action. The content of the action is reading the Quran. Is that the Quran is reading the Quran from the religion or is not from the religion? Is not. It is obviously from the religion that you should read the Quran. So in that case, if you focus on the form and don't emphasize the content, since the form is important, since what you are doing is part of the religion, then in that case, people would who look at this and say, this is a good bid'ah, a good activity. But if you focus in the form and ignore the content, people will say, this is a bad bid'ah. Because they said the Prophet ﷺ didn't do it, therefore it is bad. No, even if what you are doing is something that it's part of the religion. And that's why the term I said, you know, minhu and fihi, it become a very important. Because people who say from it, he said the Prophet ﷺ, alaysa minhu, since it is from the religion, then we haven't come with anything new, not of the religion. We just did it in a different way. But that's it. And that's what the subtlety, I said, comes to this one. But we also have to recognize that this, you know, differences that existed is not actually new. Even the companion of the Prophet ﷺ have actually differed among each other. And somebody said this is a good bid'ah or good sunnah, and the other person said no, it's a bad and it's prohibited. They differed also in this. An example, Abdullah ibn Umar consider that coming to do the prayer of the duha, you know, in the masjid is a bid'ah and prohibited. While others say, no, I mean, it's fine to come to the masjid and do the prayer of the duha. So the Prophet ﷺ never did it. But you know, people, and you know, did he fight the people who come to pray? No, but he himself said, I consider it this way. But some other companion accepted it and did it. So they just respected each other, and everybody stuck with his opinion. The other ones that we know, when we said holding the Taraweeh prayer as a group prayer, the Prophet ﷺ didn't do it, you know. And Sayyidina Umar did it, and people objected, companion objected Sayyidina Umar. He said, how can you get people to pray with one imam? Because when he went to the masjid and saw every group praying, you know, separately, he said, no, get all together and have one imam. And people objected to him, and that's why he said it's bid'atul hasana. There is actually other things that happen. We know that even the, you know, putting the Quran in one book, Sayyidina Abu Bakr didn't like it. When Sayyidina Umar proposed it to him, he said the Prophet didn't do it. But the end, he was convinced, you know. And then, you know, even Zayd ibn Thabit didn't want to do it. When asked Zayd ibn Thabit to come and write the Quran in one book, he said, no, it's a bid'ah. The Prophet ﷺ didn't do it in his lifetime. So, and they convinced him. So there is other things also in the Friday prayer. You know, Friday prayer, we have two call for prayers. This is also has never happened during the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And this was instituted actually by Sayyidina Uthman. He said, no, we'll give one call for prayer so people far away so they can hear and come, and then have another call for prayer when the imam, you know, for the imam to come. And then putting the Quran, actually arranging the Quran in the chapters, the sequence of the chapter as we have it now, it wasn't original, it was also original. And this was Sayyidina Uthman who did it, who made that arrangement. The original Mus'haf during Abu Bakr didn't have this arrangement about Surah Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran and so on, that sequence on it. Also, we know that putting the dots, if you read the older version pages from the old Quran, it doesn't have dots or doesn't have this grammatical marking. This all was introduced. And some people consider it unacceptable, and some people consider it acceptable. The problem sometimes happened when, unfortunately, people look at certain action which is clearly prohibited and to call it bid'ah, you know. One of these things would be like if somebody important, you know, a righteous person die or even a prophet, And then you build a mosque around him. And people go pray in this mosque and go visit this righteous person mosque and have events around this righteous person mosque. They consider this is bid'ah. It's bad bid'ah. But is it really the term bid'ah? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited it. So if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it prohibition on it, how can you call it bid'ah? A person violating the clear command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this case, and he said, you know, من كان قبلكم كانوا يتخذون قبور أنبيائهم وصالحيهم مساجد ألا فلا تتخذوا القبور مساجد إني أنهاكم عن ذلك. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, people before you used to take the graves or their prophets and righteous people as mosques, and I prohibit you from doing the same. So how can you call, if somebody did it, how you call it is a bid'ah? It's a violation, obviously, of the command of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's not something, he couldn't come with something new. It has happened before. But, you know, my point really to you is this. In many cases, the issues that people differ around in this masjid and in other is an issue that actually scholars differed on it. And it is important, actually, for us and for everyone is to just have respect to the different opinion of others for the sake of unity. You know, if you really are interested in the subject about this, go search it, go study it. And you might find why people say it is acceptable, why people say it is rejected. And if you feel comfortable with what is said rejected, okay, nobody forced you to follow it. And if some other person, you know, feel comfortable with that opinion that say it is acceptable, why you object to him? You know, this is not a matter of just accommodating different people, but actually respecting the scholarly opinion from others. We all follow scholarly opinion. So if I follow one and you follow different one, whom am I to object to your scholars and you who you are to object to the scholars I follow? Because our focus, frankly, as Muslim, our responsibility that we should unite ourselves. We should not create division, because this is absolutely obligation. This is obligatory on every one of us to maintain the unity among the Muslims. And there are so many verses in the Quran which Allah subhanahu condemned these. He said, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ تَفَرَّقُوا وَاخْتَلَفُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. Don't be like those who are divided among themselves and fall in disputation after receiving clear signs. What is the reward for those? For them there is a dreadful penalty. So causing a division among the Muslim because you think you are right, then you better watch, because you are subject to this warning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which he says you will have a grave or dreadful penalty from him. Now, so if the people on this occasion, and some people wants to come and have, you know, meeting and discuss the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and then do prayer on him, okay. I mean, if they feel comfortable with it, nobody will force you. If you don't like it, if you consider it a bid'ah, don't participate in it. But don't in the same time, there is others, the scholars say that's acceptable. Then you have to be, you know, tolerant and respectable enough to say, okay, they can do it, I can't do it. But they cannot force you and you cannot force them. But let me go back now to the main theme, which is the end of the few days at the end of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in this, we start with the early days of Safar in the 11th years of the Hijrah. This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on that, in the end, you know, in the closer to that early days of Safar, he went to the masjid and stand on the minbar or the pulpit and addressed actually the people. And he said, I may precede you and I have been made witness upon you. By Allah, you will meet me at the basin very soon. I have been given the keys of the worldly treasures. By Allah, I do not fear for you the return of being polytheist. And keep this in mind. Prophet ﷺ was saying, I am not afraid that the Muslim behind me, after me, will become kuffar again. He is not concerned about this one. He said, by Allah, I do not fear for you the return to being polytheist after me. But I do fear that you will start competing in the acquisition of the worldly riches. And that will create the division and fight among the Muslims. And then, and also in Safar, which was, they said that, you know, on the 29th of Safar, which is the end of Safar, also in the 11th of Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ participated in the funeral of one of the companions in the Baqiyah when he was buried. And on the way back, he suffered a headache and his temperature started rising high. But he continued, you know, he kept, you know, basically nursing, you know, the pain and the headache and the temperature, and pray, you know, continue praying, you know, for almost 11 days, leading the prayer in the masjid. But on Wednesday, which they said the seventh day of Rabi' al-Awwal, remember today is the sixth of Rabi' al-Awwal, the seventh day of Rabi' al-Awwal, in the 12 years of the Hijrah now, so that the new year, the Prophet ﷺ temperature went to rose so high, signaling a severity of his disease. He asked to pour water on him to bring the temperature down so he can get out and talk to the people. When this was done, the Prophet ﷺ felt enough, good enough, that he entered the mosque and stood on the pulpit with the people gathering around him, and he said, the curse of Allah befalls upon the Jews and the Christians, for they have made their prophets tombs or graves a place of worship. Do not make my grave as a place of worship. You know. And then he also stood, you know, continued, and he said, he whom I have ever lashed his back, I offer him my back, so that he may avenge himself from me. He whom I have, insulted him, I am offering myself that he may avenge himself from me, to insult me also. And then he descended, you know, from the minbar and performed the Zuhr prayer. And then he went again to the pulpit. That's all on that day of the seventh of Rabi' al-Awwal. And he said, Allah has given a slave the opportunity to make a choice between whatever he desires in of this world provisions or what Allah has with him. He chose what is with Allah. And at that time, you know, Sayyidina Abu Bakr started weeping and shouted, فَدَيْنَاكَ بِأَبَائِنَا وَأُمَّهَاتِنَا, means we sacrifice our father and our mother for your sake. And actually, a companion was surprised. He said, what is, why Abu Bakr is so, you know, upset from that statement and crying, since, you know, become so emotional? What the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, in abdan, you know, Allah have given a slave. He didn't specify himself, but obviously Abu Bakr understood, you know, what, you know, the Prophet ﷺ is saying. He's saying that he has been given a choice between the fortune in this life or going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he decided to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then in the 12th day of Rabi' al-Awwal, which is also 12 years of the Hijrah, then the Prophet ﷺ, and this is at the time the pain has grown so severe for him, on him, but, you know, he, and the Prophet ﷺ at that time was able to move. He was laying there when he couldn't get up. The temperature was high, the pain was severe, and what he did, he basically was able to remove the cover from his face and said several times this, and this is the last words that the Prophet ﷺ uttered to his community, to the people standing, to his family, to us. He said, As-salatu as-salah wa ma malakat aymanukum. This was the last words that the Prophet ﷺ asked us. Prayers, prayers, and those who are under your responsibility. Two words. And these two words are advice, are command from the Prophet ﷺ to all Muslims. And these two words summarize the whole religion of Islam. It provides the relationship with your Creator, which is through the Salah, and the relationship with the created, with everybody else. These two words that the Prophet ﷺ uttered is the measure of our success on this earth. And this is to cleanse our soul through the prayer and demonstrating the purity of our soul by the way we treat others who are under our control. You know, these two words, actually I said, consolidate all of the obligation in Islam. You can actually summarize the whole Islam in these two words. You know, the prayers and responsibility toward others. The prayers are so important that, you know, ignoring the prayer actually gets the people. People sometimes take the prayer so lightly, but frankly, the prayer can take you out. The only difference between a Muslim and a non-Muslim is the prayer that we perform. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ said, the covenant between us is the prayer. Whoever neglects the prayer is a kafir. You know, so it's so important, people sometimes take it lightly. But I said, the prayer is the only way to cleanse your soul, to put yourself in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He can fix all of the ills that we have in our heart and our soul and our mind. And then the second one, which is fulfilling the responsibility toward everybody who is under our control. You know, and these could be your spouse, your children, your other family member, your community, your poor people, the people who work for you, workers who work for you if you have a business. You have to have a responsibility in, you know, over them, and you have to fulfill this responsibility. And you have to give them, you have to know their rights and provide them with their rights. You have to honor them. You have to treat them fairly. You know, and remember that Allah subhanahu is watching over you. Yes, the government might put a minimum wage of $7 or $10 an hour, but you can come and say it is unfair. The person cannot live on this. I cannot live on this. Then you can pay him whatever a fair wage to it, independent of what the constraint that the government put you for the minimum one. Don't take advantage of it if you feel uncomfortable with it, because Allah subhanahu is watching you and holding you accountable for it. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. Anybody whom you have control over it, you are held responsible for it. You know, in the day of judgment, Allah will hold you accountable for it. And this is the one second word that the Prophet ﷺ have gave to every one of us. And this is so many ahadith say it. The Prophet ﷺ says, Indeed, every one of you is a shepherd, and everyone is responsible for his flock. You are responsible. Everyone is responsible. And this is the two words that the Prophet ﷺ have said, the last two advices and commands that the Prophet ﷺ have given to every one of us. If we cannot hold in this, you can forget about holding in anything else in Islam. As-salatu as-salah wa ma malakat aymanukum. And then after the Prophet ﷺ uttered these words, and he repeated several times, the Prophet ﷺ moved his hand that everybody leave the room and asked Sayyidah Aisha, you know, to come. And then, you know, he has, you know, there was a water container next to him. He put his hand on it and wiped his face. And then he laid, Sayyidah Aisha put his head over her thighs. And then in a few minutes, the Prophet ﷺ raised his hand and said, Allahumma rafiqul a'la. O Allah, the companions of the heart, of the high, the companions of the high. And then he departed his soul. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi. عدد خلقك ورضا نفسك وزنة عرشك ومداد كلماتك. اللهم هدنا فيمن هديت، وعافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيمن توليت، وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت، وقنا أسرع ما أشرم قضيت. اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوباء إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فاتبعنا أحسن. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessing, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, we ask with every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adad khalqih, warida nafsih, wazinat arshih, wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adad khalqih, warida nafsih, wazinat arshih, wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adad khalqih, warida nafsih, wazinat arshih, wa midada kalimatih. Wal asr, innal insana lafi qusr, illa ladhina amanu wa amilu s-salihat, wa tawasab bilhaq, wa tawasab bil-sabr. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.